Well, good evening, church. If you have a copy of God's word, I would invite you to turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 1. Deuteronomy chapter 1 is going to be the first of two passages we're going to look at tonight. And by the way, I'll just set up where we are for the next 2 weeks. For these next 2 weeks, beginning with me, and then next weekend will be Pastor Nathan. Our elders have asked that and have decided to focus on two particular areas of biblical counseling that come up again and again in the life of our church. And so it's a specific, focused look, and we pray, a practical look for many of you into some areas of great concern and great need for a lot of us in this church. And so it's me this weekend, and then next weekend is Pastor Nathan, and then Pastor Robbie, Lord willing, returns, and will carry us with this continuing on the study of the Holy Spirit right up and through till Easter. But tonight, the task ahead of us is to look at one of, I think, the most invasive, the one of the most pervasive, and the one of the most excused sins in the church. In fact, when I say excused, I mean not repented of, kind of looked upon as light, not really caring, that's not really a big deal, sins in the church. And by the way, when we were picking out, hey, here's some biblical counseling topics, Craig, Nathan, which ones would you like? Pastor Nathan picked his, and I looked at the list, and I was like, that's the one I want, because that's the one I struggle with the most. So tonight, we look at complaining, a grumbling, murmuring heart. This sin lives everywhere and anywhere. It's in the heart of the kids you raise in your home. I want more candy. I want more this. I want more TV, more toys, more fun. I don't know if that sounds familiar to you. That's in the heart of our young people. More entertainment. I want more experiences, more clothes, more stuff. It's in the heart of the married. More vacation, more things. It's in the heart of the single. More companionship, more validation. It's in the heart of the old. More health, more time, more money, more security, more status, more respect. In fact, the general lack of contentment that is everywhere drives us in so many of the things that we do. It drives us in what we spend. It drives our thoughts. It drives our actions. The entire advertising world is built upon the fact that you and I and the rest of the world are not content with what we have. The continual drive in your heart to compare yourself, to compare your spouse, to compare your kids, to compare your job, your salary, your house, your car, your health, your continual desire to compare yourself is because that you are not satisfied with what you have. You're not content. The reason why you and I get so bored and so disinterested with the things that we buy one microsecond after we buy them is because I'm not content with what I have. So often, why we eat so much and sleep so much and drink so much is because I'm not content with the life that I have. It's in the church too. The prosperity gospel is founded on a lack of contentment. It's not enough that Jesus died for my sins. It's not enough that I have eternal life in Christ Jesus. I should get more from this. I should get more in this life. Think about this. How much of your time is spent in social media looking at other people's lives, leaving you feeling miserable and discontented and wanting more? How much of your interactions with friends leave you complaining and wanting more? How much time at your church leaves you murmuring and wanting more, wanting different, wanting better than what you got? How many conversations have you had this week where you're talking to the person said to you, you know what? I got everything I need. I'm good. I don't need anything else. Phew, I bet. How many times this week have you thought to yourself, you know what? I have enough. I just have enough. Psalm 23 is one of the most famous psalms in all the Bible, and it begins this way. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Is that your reality tonight? I don't need anything. I literally am content with everything. This lack of contentment, this murmuring, this complaining in our heart, the Bible calls out as a sin. In fact, it points to it in several passages of God's word. Your grumbling is not against us, but against the Lord, Exodus 16. Do all things without grumbling, Philippians. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Be content with what you have. For he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. God's word calls it a sin. So the point of tonight is for us to understand, to believe in our hearts, to embrace the reality that we must be done with complaining. A complaining heart and a believer in Jesus Christ do not fit together. You know what I want to be done with tonight? I want to be done with excusing what God in his word says is inexcusable. I want to be done with that. I want to be done with saying, you know what, complaining's okay. Everybody does it. I want to be done with that. I want to embrace the truth of God's word and say, you know what, complaining is not fitting in my life. Complaining is a sin. It's dark, it's wicked, it's of Satan. And when I grumble in my heart and complain with my mouth and murmur, I stand in direct opposition with God. So today I don't want to rationalize it anymore. I'm preaching to myself as I preach to you. God hates complaining hearts. And so I want to hate it too. So here's what we're going to do today. We're going to take a little bit of a systematic theology. We're going to look at a principal passage, Deuteronomy chapter 1, and then illustrate what complaining does and where it takes us. And then I want us to move to Philippians chapter 4 and see the medicine, see where God can take us out of this. And by the way, while we're doing this, we're going to be building out a diagram that I hope will be helpful in understanding what's going on. So let me give you this. First point in our talk tonight is this. It's a very basic outline. It's this. First point, stop complaining. Okay? Stop complaining. From this passage, I want to show you the horror of where complaining can take you. I want to show you what a nightmare complaining is, how toxic it is for your life, and the great loss to which it will take you. So the context of our passage is the book of Deuteronomy. It's the second time that Moses gives the law to the people of Israel. After they have left the bondage and slavery of ancient Egypt, and just before they're about to enter a new land that was promised to them for the second time. The first time Moses gives the law and they're about to enter the land, it doesn't go so well. Not well at all. Actually, Moses tells us from the passage in front of you, Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 19. Then we sent out from Horeb and we went through all the great and terrifying wilderness that you saw on the way to the hill country of the Amorites as the Lord our God commanded us. And we came up to Kadesh Barnea. There's some geography there, so I found this great map that will help you explain, understand what this looks like. Sometimes you just can't find the map you want, so it's better to just draw it. So this is the Nile River here. And then they leave the land of Egypt. They go down to Sinai. That's where the law is given to them. That's where Moses is on the mountain. He gets the law code. And this is wilderness area here. And then this is where they're going to eventually cross in through Jericho. That's where that is. The Dead Sea, the Sea of Galilee. That's the Jordan River that connects it. This is the Mediterranean Ocean, helpfully illustrated by the boat. Jerusalem's right about there, but Jerusalem doesn't exist by the name of Jerusalem at the time, okay? And this is all wilderness area here. And this is Kadesh Barnea. And I know what you're thinking. Ah, you know what? But in the Sinai Desert, there are no cacti because cacti are indigenous to North America. And if you're thinking that, well, then you're way off track here, okay? This is just desert, okay? That's a desert and good land, Kadesh Barnea. Here's what Kadesh Barnea looks like now. It's a nice land, but this is the promised land over this way. So they're in this area. They're assembled there. That's Kadesh Barnea. And then what happens in this place? Well, verse 20, and I said to you in that place, I said to you, you've come to the hill country of the Amorites, which the Lord our God is giving us. See, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up, take possession, as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has told you. Do not fear or be dismayed. Pause. Question, why did Moses say, do not fear or be dismayed? Because they were fearing and being dismayed. A fear has come into their life. A crisis has hit them. And in the crisis, in the fear, what's their response? You can read about the original story if you want to go to Numbers 13 and 14, but Moses summarizes here in verse 22. Then all of you came near to me and said, wait. Let's send men before us that they may explore the land for us and bring us word again of the way by which we will go up to the cities into which we have come, or which we shall come. verse 23, the thing seemed good to me, and I took 12 men from you, one man from each tribe, and they turned and went up into the hill country and came to the valley of Eshcol and spied it out. What was their response to the crisis, to the affliction? We could ask your kids, maybe in Harvest Kids right now, if I leaned over and said, hey, kids, when crisis comes, when there's a scary thing that happens in your life, when there's something that comes and you just don't know what to do, what should you do? And your kids, because they've gone to Harvest Kids and because the kids understand this, they'd say, we should trust God. Yeah, that's right. They get it. I don't get it, though. Maybe you don't get it either. The Israelites didn't get it. When the crisis comes, what do? Affliction, crisis, difficulty causes them to send men before us. You see that in verse 22? Let us send men before us. Look quick down at verse 30. We'll come there in a minute, but look at verse 30. The Lord your God who goes before you. Whoa. The Lord your God who goes before you. They were sending men to do God's job. Let me show you this diagram. This is what I think is a great way to accelerate complaining in your life. When you're faced with a crisis in your life and God promises you his strength, the way down into growing complaint and growing loss, the first thing you can do is abandon that strength. The first thing you can do is say, you know what? I want to increase complaining in my life. And so I'm going to read the commands and read the understanding that God is strong and he can do anything. And I'm going to reject that. I'm going to walk away from that. My first response is not to seek his strength. My first response is to reach for my wallet. My first response is to go into my own wisdom and my own skills and my own talent. My first response is to call my own doctor and ask for my own friends. My first response is to send men in front of me. When a crisis comes or when life isn't working the way I want it to work, I immediately look to solve this with my own hands. Do you want to grow in complaining in your life? Do you want to turn pro at complaining? Well, then you abandon God's strength. Look what happens next, verse 25. And they took in their hands some of the fruit of the land, and they brought it down to us and brought us word again and said, it's a good land that the Lord our God is giving us. Verse 26. Yet you would not go up, but rebelled against the command of the Lord your God. And you murmured in your tents and said, because the Lord hated us, he has brought us into the land of Egypt to give us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us. What are they doing? Complaining. Murmuring in their tents. Going back and talking amongst themselves. That word for murmuring in the text there is about, it speaks of complaining noises under your breath. You know what that's like? You know what that's like? The line's so long. Kids, they don't respect me. How come she doesn't listen? I can't believe this. Nobody listens. What are they complaining about? What are they murmuring? They say the Lord hates us. He wants to destroy us. Let's go back to the diagram. You want to grow more in complaining and see more loss? When you're faced with God's character, here's the next thing you do. You want to accuse that character. The Lord hates us. He doesn't care. He doesn't want, when crisis comes, not only will I do what I want, but I will also now accuse God. Accuse God of being wicked in it. The Israelites accuse God of hating them and of wanting them dead, of luring them into the wilderness to destroy them. I told you Numbers 13 and 14 tell us the actual event. I think it's helpful to go to Numbers 14 to show you what they're talking about in this moment. Look at this text. Then all the congregation raised a loud cry, and the people wept that night. And all the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become a prey. Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt And they said to one another, let's choose a leader and go back to Egypt. They accuse God of doing wrong. They haven't relied on his strength, and now they turn and accuse him of his character. God, don't you even care? Look at what you're doing to me. You put me here. You got to get us out of this. You must not care about me. There must be nothing. They accuse God, who in his word tells of how much he has expressed his love for you. This God who has even sent his own son to die for us. We say to him, it's not enough, God. It's not enough, God. You got to give me this job. You got to fix my kids. You've got to get me that toy. I want that to wear. I want that house. I want. Or I don't want this. I don't want this trial. I don't want this difficulty. I don't want this pain. I don't want to wait anymore. I'm tired of this. God, you must hate me. Or even worse, God, you don't care about me. God doesn't even rip about me. You accuse God in his character. Proverbs 19:3 puts the nail on the head here. When a man's folly, when a man's a fool, he brings his way to ruin and his heart rages against the Lord. That's rejecting the strength of the Lord, accusing God in his character. What comes next? Verse 28. Where are we going up? Our brothers have made our hearts melt, saying, the people are greater and taller than we. The cities are great and fortified up to heaven. Exaggeration? I think so. And besides, we have seen the sons of the Anakim there. Do you know who the Anakim are? Neither do I. I guess history didn't seem to make a big deal of them. Not a big deal. Verse 29, then I said to them, do not be in dread or afraid of them. The Lord your God, who goes before you, will himself fight for you, just as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes and in the wilderness, where you've seen how the Lord your God carried you as a man carries his son all the way that you went until you came to this place. Here's the third thing you'll do if you want to grow in complaining. You want to forget now God's actions. You want to all of a sudden forget the things that God has done in your life. So you reject his strength when the crisis comes, and then you accuse his character, even though you've never relied on his strength, and complaining grows, and then now you completely forget everything that God has done in your life. Moses tells the people, look, don't you remember what he's done? Don't you remember how he's delivered you from the Egyptians and how he carried you in the wilderness every day like a man carries his son? And when you slide into complaining and bitterness and murmuring and grumbling in your heart, you forget this stuff. You forget what God has done in your life. You will say instead, you will not say, look at what God has done. You will say, what has God done for me lately? This is one of the greatest evils of complaining, because complaining blinds me to the realities of the gospel, that God is good and he loves me, that I don't deserve anything I have. In fact, and yet I have received in Christ something of far greater value than any affliction that I'm facing. And when you're in that place, you've accused God, you've forsaken his strength, and you've forgotten his deeds, it's a very quick step now to just disbelieve the person of God. You just disbelieve. You just say, whatever. I don't believe it. Verse 32, yet in spite of this word, you did not believe the Lord your God, who went before you in the way to seek you out a place to pitch your tent, in fire by night and the cloud by day to show you the way in which you should go. This is the end of the line for complaining. Do you realize this? If you nurture and allow and foster and coddle complaining in your heart, it will end in unbelief in God, and the loss is great. You will cease to believe in God, and you will destroy yourself with a murmuring heart. The generation of Israelites would forfeit their share of the promised land, and it would go to their children. In fact, that's the crowd to whom Moses is speaking to right now. Here's a big truth, though. Complaining always leads to great loss. Never, never do you win by complaining. You don't gain anything by complaining. Okay, so why is this so bad? Jesus says, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. I hope you're understanding this. The problem with complaining is not that words come out of my mouth that are negative. It's not that I'm some downer guy at a party. Oh, blah, blah, blah. Jesus is more concerned about the heart that speaks the complaining. Because at the root of complaining is a heart that says, I don't believe God is able. At the root of complaining is a heart that says, God is not good. At the heart of complaining is a heart that says, what has God done for me? Is God even there? When complaining is fostered in my life and fostered in my heart, this is the depths that it takes me to. I think that for many here, I think that for too many, including myself, there are too many days where we have created dramas in our minds where we are the main character in the story, and the story is a tragedy, and everything that happens to us in the day places us as the victim. We are always being given the short end of the stick. My car is too old. The kids are not behaving. My career is not enough. There's not enough money. I don't get the attention I deserve. The Starbucks line is too long. I don't get the respect I need. My boss doesn't care. My church isn't meeting my needs. The guy speaking up front isn't the guy that I like. Jeremiah Burroughs, he said this, and I think you're getting this now. Jeremiah Burroughs said this. Thank you. Oh, that we could but convince men and women that a murmuring spirit is a greater evil than any affliction, whatever the affliction. You get this? If I could just convince men and women that a murmuring spirit is greater affliction than any affliction they could ever face. The murmuring in my heart is worse than any trial I could ever go through. I'm praying today, in our hearts, we make a stand and say, you know what? You know what? I'm not going to make excuses anymore for things in God's word that he says are inexcusable. Complaining does not befit a child of God. I want to be done with the sin of complaining. So how do we get out of this? How do we get out of this place that we're in? How do we move from complaining to contentment? Well, this is point number two in our outline. It's this. Start being content, okay? It's a very complicated outline. Stop complaining, start being content. We're going to use Deuteronomy 1, 9 through 13. And what I want to show you is that it really, Moses acts as the opposite to how the Israelites are behaving. Moses behaves in the way that we all should be behaving and seeking out the Lord in the way that Moses is doing. So in many ways, we're going to reverse the diagram and we're going to pull up all the right things that we should be doing. Instead of disbelieving God's person, I need to be believing God's person. Instead of forgetting God's action, I need to remember God's action. Instead of accusing God's character, I need to ascribe to God's character. Instead of abandoning his strength, I need to surrender to his strength. So Moses is going to act as the example of what it looks like to be content. Okay, so step up number one, I need to believe God's person. Look with me back through the text, verse 21. See, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up. This is Moses' words. Take possession as the Lord your God, the God of your fathers has told you. Don't be afraid. Don't be dismayed. This God is the God of our fathers. He's the one who called Abraham. He's the one who called Isaac. He's the one who led Joseph into Egypt to save his people. Moses understands this. Moses understands that God brings every situation into your life. That's a big truth. God brings every situation in your life. God is God. He's sovereign. He's ruling over everything. He rules over your life. He orchestrates everything in your life. I don't know music, but I learned of a musical term called a discordant note. A discordant note sounds, if you hear it alone, sounds like an awful note. But when you place it into a greater symphony, it begins to make sense. You know, so many times we live our lives and look at the discordant notes of our lives. We say, what's going on with this? And we don't back away. We don't see that God is bringing this into our lives. God brings the good. God brings the difficulty. God brings them with great purpose into our lives. Here's a couple of passages of scripture that speak to this. Lamentations chapter 3, is not from the mouth of the Most High that good and bad come? Not wickedness. Understand this. God does not do wickedness, but God brings difficulty. God is sovereign over his creation. He brings difficulty into our lives. Isaiah chapter 45, I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and I create calamity. I am the Lord who does these things. God is sovereign. The first step out of this is to believe God's purpose. Believe the truth, church, right now. Whatever the affliction, whatever the trial, whatever the difficulty, the Lord knows what you're going through. He is the God of this trial also. But we're going to take a second step up in that diagram. And we've got to remember God's deeds. Instead of forgetting the deeds of the Lord, we need to remember the deeds of the Lord. Look again at verse 31. These are Moses' words. You have seen how the Lord your God carried you as a man carries his son all the way that you went until you came to this place. Verse 30. You can save verse 31 for the next point. Verse 30, he, the Lord your God, who goes before you, will himself fight for you, just as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes and in the wilderness, where you have seen how the Lord your God carried you all the way until you came to this place. Do you remember how he saved you from Egypt? Do you remember how he protected you in the wilderness? He took on a global superpower by himself. And it wasn't even hard for him. Do you remember the deeds of the Lord? How about for us? What has he done for me? What has he done for me even just today? We got to remember God's deeds. But then Moses goes on. We also have to ascribe God's character. This is now verse 31. You've seen how the Lord your God carried you as a man carries his son all the way until you went to this place. As a man carries his son. Does that speak of hatred? Does that speak of somebody trying to kill somebody? Does it speak of love? Does it speak of neglect of children? No. The image Moses holds on to is God picking up a child and carrying him. Do you remember times in your life like this? Have there been times in your life where you just felt like, God, you've carried me? Could it be that right now in this time, in this season, the difficulty, the hard time, the thing that maybe is causing you to complain the most, that God is maybe carrying you in this? Do you fail to see that God is carrying you in this? You know what I want to be done with today? I want to be done with allowing my feelings in the present moment to tell me that God is not good. That my seeing something happening in this moment, in this day, or the news that I get, or the relationships I have with people, in that moment, my feelings override the truth of God's word, and I start to view God as not good because of the situation and because of my feelings. I want to be done with that. I want to cling to the truth that God is good, God is faithful, God carries me like he carries a son. I believe that God knows me, and he loves me. Now, this life is not going to be easy. He promises me this. I look at the master. I look at Jesus. His life's not easy. And if they persecuted him, they're going to persecute me. And if life is difficult for him, life is going to be for me too. But I want to believe the truth, church. Maturity does this, though. It lines up the events of our life. It looks back and says, look at how faithful my God has been. He's been faithful every day of my life. He's always provided for me. He's always met every need. Why is today any different? Why is today the day that he's choosing to not love you? It's not true. Don't listen to the feelings. God cares. The Lord says to you, you think I don't love you? I carried you out of Egypt. I carried you out of Egypt like my son. He says to you today, you think I don't love you? I crucified my son for you. that you would have life. You think I don't care what you're going through today? You think I don't care about the hurts and the pains? Out of this, we're able to see clearly and say, well, far from hating me, God loves me with a great and an awesome love. He is faithful, he is just, he is perfect, he is holy. Instead of accusing God, my heart cultivates joy as it looks to God's great character. The fourth step up is quite simple. It's this: surrender to God's strength. Moses says again, go up, go up. Take possession as the Lord your God, the God of your fathers, has told you. Don't fear, be dismayed. All you have to do is go and take it. And why? Verse 30, because it's the Lord who goes before you. He will fight for you. You don't have to be strong. You don't have to know how to figure out this trial. You don't have to figure out this affliction or difficulty or crisis in your life. You don't have to figure that out. One of the greatest truths of the gospel is that you don't need any strength. One of the greatest truths of the gospel is that God does not need you to ever be strong. His strength is more than enough. But, God does require that you surrender to his strength. How do I stop complaining in my life? How do I lead my sick heart away from murmuring and into gratitude and into thankfulness and into contentment while I walk out this way? I gotta believe that God is who he says he is. I gotta remember the works of the Lord, even on the days when it doesn't seem clear, even on the days when my feelings wanna cloud it. I've gotta ascribe the character of God, that God loves me and God is sovereign and God is good. That's true always. And then surrender to his great strength. But in reality, this is very hard to do. In the moment, this is very hard to do. Have you ever tried to stop complaining about something and it didn't work? So this leads us to our final question, which is this: how do I do it? How do I get out of that? So for this, I want you to turn with me to Philippians chapter 4. Please turn. I do want you to get God's word in front of you. And I promise we're not going to go back to Deuteronomy. I'm not going to do that to you. Okay. Philippians chapter 4. Okay, great, Craig. I see the evil of complaining. And I see the goodness of contentment. I want the blessing of living in this place. How then, when it is such a struggle each and every day, how can I possibly live this way? The Apostle Paul in Philippians chapter 4, he weighs in from a jail cell. So when a guy writes you from a jail cell and says, I'm content, I think it's legit. Philippians 4, verse 11. Not that I'm speaking of being in need, for I've learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. How do we do it? It's right there. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Through him, through him, through him. Paul doesn't say, I can do all things by logically thinking the right steps. I can do all things by understanding and guarding my heart and putting up these accountability structures and getting some basic barriers. I can do all things by recalling and being patient and praying in the Starbucks line. And I can do all things by pausing and backing away and counting to 10 with my kids and being content in that moment. And I can be content in my workplace if I just remember some mantra of being, no. What I want you to understand, what I need you to understand, what I need you to grip is that you can't battle complaining in your heart in any other way except through him who gives you strength. Through him who gives you strength. Through him, Paul says. Jesus says to us tonight, apart from me, you can do nothing. Remember that verse? Paul says, through him, I can do all things. This is what I want to do tonight. I want to no longer excuse what God in his word says is inexcusable. I want to be done with the sin of complaining in my life. I want to fight complaining in my heart. You want to fight complaining in your heart? You want to fight to win? You want to fight to win? Well, then you do it through Jesus Christ. There is no other way to accomplish this except through the power and the person of Jesus Christ. If I said to you tonight, hey, here's how you fight complaining, four steps out, there you go. You walk out with four steps, you will fail, fail, fail. It is Jesus Christ who walks you out in his strength, in his power, by his grace. Jesus says to us tonight, I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. Soaking my heart in the truth of Jesus, in the truths of the gospel, destroys complaining in my life and brings contentment. The gospel vaporizes complaining. It's that simple. Because through the gospel, only through the gospel, do I see him for who he really is, the God of love who came for me. Because only through the gospel do I believe that God is who he says he is, the God of sacrifice who died for me. Only through the gospel do I see his great works, the God who broke sin upon himself. Only through the gospel do I fall upon his strength for my life, the God who can do anything, the God who accomplished the impossible. It leads the heart into saying, I have Jesus. I have Jesus. What more do I need? I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I can't do it. You can't do it unless Jesus helps. But in Jesus, with Jesus, in his strength, grumbling will turn into gratitude and complaining turns into contentment. Lord, help us. Lord, help us, please. Let me pray. As I pray, I'd like to invite the communion servers to come forward also. Lord Jesus, it is a universal condition of the human heart to complain, to grumble, to murmur, to look upon the things of God that we have been given by God, to look upon the trials, the difficulties, the hardships, to look upon the blessings that aren't enough blessings, to look upon the pains that we don't want, the pleasures that we want more of. It's a universal condition that we murmur and complain against you. But that does not make it right. In fact, it speaks more to its wrongness if we all struggle with it. Lord Jesus, we cannot defeat this sin in our own strength. We need the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ upon us. Lord, could you give us a sense and renewed heart for the truths of the gospel tonight, of recognizing again how needy we are for you, how far we were from you, how much you have loved us, and how you have rescued us, and how you have redeemed us. And God, I pray that the little things that bother us, the self-righteousness in our heart that says, I deserve more, I deserve better, I deserve different, would fade away. And a delight in the Lord Jesus Christ would remain. A recognition that what we do deserve, we didn't get. And what we don't deserve, the goodness we have received in Christ Jesus. So Lord, now we turn to the Lord's Supper, and Some traditions call this the Eucharist, which is a Greek word meaning giving thanks. And it seems right, Lord, that we would turn now to give thanks to you. Out of complaining now comes gratitude, a thankfulness. And Lord, I pray that in an unusual way tonight, Lord, the grumbling of our hearts that we struggle with, the things that are bothering us, the things that we always resort to, Lord, would be replaced now with a gratitude for the Lord Jesus Christ and his love for us. God, I pray that as conviction abounds in our hearts, we would run to you and now surrender to you and find great thankfulness from us. Lord, would you be blessed in this? We commit this time to you now in Jesus' name. Amen.